Shopping for a computer can be really confusing, but in this buying guide, I'll simplify all of the technical specs and walk you through a foolproof step-by-step process for finding the computer that's just right for your needs. If you're shopping for a new computer and want to talk to an expert like me for free one-on-one help, you can fill out a request at retailey.com or call us using the toll-free number in this video's description. I'm not going to waste any of your precious time talking about simple things like touchscreen versus non-touchscreen, wireless peripherals, or what ports you should look for. All of those are extremely straightforward, and you likely already know if you want or need them in your next computer. Rather, I want to spend this time helping decode the most confusing, important technical aspects you need to understand when buying a new computer. So by the end of this video, you'll know exactly what type of computer you should be shopping for, how much storage capacity you need, how many gigabytes of RAM your daily tasks require, how many gigahertz you should be shopping for in a processor, and the tiny pitfalls and things to look out for in each. I want to start with the most important aspects of buying a computer and work our way backwards. So first, let's talk about what you should look for in a processor. Bear with me here. This is the most complex topic we'll cover in this video. But if you give me a couple of minutes, I can explain it in very easy to understand terms. Your computer's processor is its brain, and it's the main reason a computer gets slow or bogs down later in its life. If you've ever experienced that, it's likely because you didn't pay for a strong enough processor when initially buying your computer, as the processor is also one of the components most likely to raise or lower the price of a computer. So how do you know how powerful a computer's processor is? Processor speed is measured in gigahertz, abbreviated with an uppercase GH and a lowercase Z. Don't worry, I'm not going to bore you with a technical explanation of what a gigahertz is. You only need to know how to interpret them. The more gigahertz you see, the more powerful that computer's processor is. Also, if you see a dual core or a quad core, you should multiply the gigahertz rating respectively by 2 or 4. So if you're comparing a computer with 3.2 gigahertz processor to a computer with a 1.6 gigahertz quad core processor, the 1.6 gigahertz quad core is roughly twice as capable as the other option. If you're a light duty user, meaning you only use your computer for simple tasks like browsing the internet, editing documents, checking email, etc., you don't need to spend extra money for a powerful processor. The lighter duty models toward the bottom of the market should suit your needs just fine. However, if you run several programs on your computer at once, or you purchase a computer once every 7 to 10 years, you'll want to purchase a mid-range processor that's slightly more powerful. Otherwise, you could be faced with a very slow, frustrating computer several years before you're due to upgrade. If you're a heavy-duty user that does a lot of intense video work, design work, 3D modeling, computer gaming, etc., you'll want to buy a computer with a powerful processor. You'll pay a lot more, but at the end of the day, it's the only type of computer that's going to suit your needs. That probably leads you to the question, what makes for a heavy-duty or a light-duty processor? How do I know the difference? Simply compare the options currently on the market. If you see a 2.1 GHz processor, a 1.9 GHz dual-core processor, and a 2.5 GHz quad-core processor, one is a light, one is a medium, and one is a heavy-duty model. Now that we're done talking about processors, I want to take a minute to apologize for putting you through that. I know it's complex, and if you need to, feel free to loop the video back and watch that section again. I'm afraid there's no simpler way to explain it, but if you're shopping for a computer by yourself and you don't have an expert like me by your side to help, it's essential you understand these concepts very well. Moving on to the next most important feature to pay attention to, RAM. RAM stands for Random Access Memory, which, simply put, is your computer's bandwidth. As the background processes and programs run on your computer, they utilize bandwidth, which you only have a finite amount of. If your computer has a super fast brain but not enough bandwidth for the programs you're running, that can also bog down your machine. I have another video that answers the question of how much RAM you need in detail, which I've linked to in this video's description. Without getting into another long, drawn-out explanation, here's a very good rule of thumb. If you're a light-duty user, buy at least 4 GB. Medium duty? Buy 8 GB. And heavy-duty users should buy 16 gigabytes. But in today's tech climate, any more than 16 gigabytes doesn't do much. The return on investment is almost zilch. Again, if you want more than this rule of thumb, follow the link in this video's description labeled, "How much RAM do I need?" That brings us to the third most important spec, storage space. This will either be indicated by the abbreviation HD or HDD for hard disk drives, or SSD for solid state drives. Solid state drives are rising in popularity because they're significantly faster and more efficient than hard disks, but they're also significantly more expensive. Bottom line, if you can afford a solid state drive, it's money well spent. If you can't or don't want to, there's nothing wrong with the traditional hard disk drives. Now for the really important aspect of storage. How much do you need? Light duty and medium duty users shouldn't need more than 500 gigabytes to 1 TB of storage space. Most baseline models in today's tech climate come with at least that much, and that's all you should ever need. Besides, if you run out of space, you can always purchase an easy to use external hard drive to handle the overflow. Even the heaviest duty users can make do with 500 gigabytes of storage if they use an external hard drive. But if you don't want to use an external hard drive, and you work with HD video or other gigantic files, try to get at least 1 to 2 TB of internal storage. And that brings us to our final topic for this buying guide, which type of computer you should buy. You probably already have a pretty good idea of what type of computer you need, but I want to quickly run through your options and explain the pros and cons of each. If portability isn't important to you, then you're probably shopping for a desktop or all-in-one computer. A traditional desktop has a tower that's separate from the monitor and typically rests on the ground below, but an all-in-one sits on top of the desk in one piece, with all of the hardware and components cleverly hidden behind the monitor on your desk. All-in-ones are typically regarded as more sleek and attractive, but beware of the drawbacks if you're planning to buy one. They're typically 20 to 30% more expensive than a traditional desktop computer with the exact same amount of power and specs. And they're difficult, if not impossible, to upgrade should you need more storage space or speed down the road. So if you choose an all-in-one, choose carefully and know that you're paying a substantial amount of money for that sleek design. The same goes for shoppers seeking a more portable computer. You likely know if you need a laptop or desktop, but what about laptops versus Ultrabooks, tablet PCs, or 2-in-1 models that are rising in popularity? The exact same drawbacks for an all-in-one versus a desktop apply to a traditional laptop versus an Ultrabook, tablet PC, or 2-in-1 model. You get a sleek design along with a little added portability, but you'll pay substantially less for a traditional laptop with the same capabilities. And Ultrabooks, tablet PCs, and 2-in-1s are difficult or impossible to upgrade should you need to. Is the price increase worth it? It just depends on your personal preferences when weighing style and portability versus practicality and value. That's it! There are still some minor details you want to pay attention to, like optical ports, media card readers, touch screens, etc., but the importance of all those features combined is trivial compared to the essential computer specs I've covered in this video. Paying attention to the topics I've covered in this video will determine 90% of how happy you are with your new computer for years to come, so choose wisely. Still not sure what you need to be looking for in a computer? Head over to Retailey.com and myself or another expert will give you free one-on-one advice to help you find your perfect computer. I hope you found this video helpful. If so, please give it a thumbs up below, subscribe to our channel, or follow us on social media using the links in this video's description. If you have any questions that I didn't answer, leave them in the comment section below and one of our computer experts will answer it shortly. We'll be right back.